Good morning. Good morning. Good to see you all. Let us prepare ourselves for our hour of worship, prayer, song, and meditation. We bid you welcome, who come with weary spirit seeking rest, who come with troubles that are too much with you, who come hurt and afraid. We bid you welcome, who come with hope in your heart, who come with anticipation in your step, who come proud and joyous. We bid you welcome who are seekers of a new faith, who come to probe and explore, who come to learn. We bid you welcome who enter this church as a homecoming, who have found here room for your spirit, who find in this people a family. Whoever you are, whatever you are, wherever you are on your own personal journey, we bid you welcome. And now may we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we will sing together our first hymn, The Lord is My Shepherd.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. The reading I have chosen is Psalm 84. And I was not able to be here when the choir were singing it, but I'm here to say it. How amiable are thy tabernacles, O Lord of hosts! My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God. Yes, the sparrow hath found a house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even thine altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are they that dwell in the house, and they will still be praising thee. Blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, in whose heart are the ways of them, who, passing through the valley of Baca, made it a well. The rain also filleth the pools. They go from strength to strength. Every one of them in Zion appeareth before God. O Lord of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Behold, O God, our shield, and look upon the face of thine anointed. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord God will give grace and glory. No good thing will be withheld from them that walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man that trusteth in thee. Amen.
Yesterday was International Transgender Memorial Day, and I'd like to just read for you, or not just read for you, but express a prayer to mark that day for all those who declare themselves transgender and who have suffered in the past. And this is a very appropriate prayer. It's a little prayer I picked up in Sheffield Cathedral. And Sheffield Cathedral describes itself as a place for all people. And it's a prayer of Saint Anselm. So this is a prayer for all those who are transgender and have suffered. O Lord my God, teach my heart this day where and how to find you. You have made me and remade me, and you have bestowed on me all the good things I possess, and still I do not know you. I have not yet done that for which I was made. Teach me to seek you, for I cannot seek you unless you teach me or find you, unless you show yourself to me. Let me seek you in my desire. Let me desire you in my seeking. Let me find you by loving you. Let me love you when I find you. Amen. And now may we sing our second hymn, Lead Kindly Light. 325 in the book. For the second reading, I've picked a piece called Counsels, written by Marge Percy, who I believe was a noted American Unitarian. But it's just a piece that appeals to me in because I sit on the executive of a body called Community Dialogue, where we bring people from different parts of Belfast and other parts of Northern Ireland to have dialogue with each other rather than beating each other up. And it works in part, not completely, but it works in part. And I just, this appealed to me in a slightly humorous way, Counsels by Marge Percy. I'm not sure she meant it to be humorous, but I saw the humor in it. We must sit down and reason together. Perhaps we should sit in the dark. In the dark, we could utter our feelings. In the dark, we could propose and describe and suggest. In the dark, we could not see who speaks, and only the words would say what they say. No one would speak more than twice. No one would speak less than once. Those saying what we feel and what we want, what we fear for ourselves and each other into the dark. Perhaps we could begin to listen. The women must learn to dare to speak. The men must learn to bother to listen. The women must learn to say, "I think this is so." The men must learn to stop dancing solos on the ceiling. After each speaks, she or he will say a ritual phrase. "It is not I who speaks, but the wind. Wind blows through me, long after me is the wind." I find a bit of humor in that, but there's some sense in it. The only thing about having conversations in the dark, then you wouldn't get to see who hit you. That's the downside. But I like it, it appeals to me. And now the choir. Now, last Sunday, we marked Remembrance Sunday, and in doing so, I spoke about the horrors of war as expressed by that great American poet, Walt Whitman. Now, it was not my intention to speak about any war this week, and particularly World War I. But however, having said that, a particular story really caught my imagination. Some of you might be aware of it, but I want to share it with you. It's about a young British Army captain who was held as a prisoner of war in Germany during the First World War. His name was Captain Campbell, and he joined the army in 1903. At the beginning of the First World War in 1914, he was in charge of the 1st Battalion, East Surrey Regiment. And he led his soldiers into battle in the northwest of France. Now, one of the engagements that he was involved in was an incredibly intense, brutal battle. And Captain Campbell was seriously injured, and he ended up being captured by the Germans. He was taken to Cologne to be treated in a hospital and then sent to a prisoner of war camp in Magdeburg, northeast Germany. Now, it just so happens, I know both of those places. Not that it's got anything to do with the story, but it's really more interesting when you read a story and you know both places. I preached in Cologne about 4 years ago, and it's a wonderful city on the River Rhine, or as the locals say, Köln. And Magdeburg, anyone that knows Magdeburg will know it's when the German Democratic Republic or East Germany was in existence, it was the first big town you hit once you crossed from West Germany into East Germany. And it was a very strange experience. Not just to go by train, but I drove one time, and to go into Magdeburg was a completely different experience in East Germany than to be in West Germany. Now, I just thought, because I know both of those places, and it made the story appeal even more to me. Anyway, 2 years into his experience in the prison of war camp, 2 years later, he was notified that his mother, this is Captain Campbell, was notified that his mother was dying from cancer. Now, this deeply upset this young man of 29 years of age. And he was terrified he would not see his mum before he died, which would suggest that as a young man, he was incredibly close to his mother. Now, when you imagine this is 1916, halfway through the First World War, and you picture the incredible destruction that's going on throughout Europe at this stage. The horrendous loss of life all along the Western Front, unimaginable. However, despite all that, the strangest of things happened. Captain Campbell, incredibly, wrote to Kaiser Wilhelm II, asking the Kaiser to permit him to travel back to England to see his mother before she died. He wrote that letter not expecting to ever hear back. However, this is kind of a good story about the Kaiser. Kaiser gets a lot of bad stuff. There's a good story about the Kaiser. The Kaiser responded and granted him 2 weeks special leave from the prisoner of war camp. The leave was conditional, and it included the following: that as a gentleman and as an army officer, British army officer, he would pledge to return. Campbell promised and gave his word and his honor as an officer and a gentleman, that he would return to the commander of the camp to be passed on to Kaiser Wilhelm. Now, I'm not sure how he returned to England, but however, Captain Campbell left the camp and was able to spend a week at his mother's bedside in Gravesend in Kent. I've been to Kent, I've never been to Gravesend. But he spent a week at his mother's side in Gravesend in Kent. And part of the arrangement was that he would be there for his mum's funeral. But his mother did not die while he was there. And because he had given his word as a gentleman and an officer, he returned after the 2 weeks. A few days traveling there, a week with his mother, and a few days getting back. So even though his mom didn't die while he was there, he felt he was obliged to return to the prison of war camp in Magdeburg. Now, I have to be clear on one thing. There was, in this story, from what I've researched and read about the story, and I'm clear on this, there was never a suggestion that the Germans would have taken it out on the other British prisoners There was never a sense of threat existed that if the deal was not completed by Captain Campbell. No way were any other prisoners threatened if he did not return. He had made a contract with his captors, and he would not even consider breaking that contract. Nor, by the way, when he was in Britain visiting his mother, nor did his senior officers in his regiment or otherwise try or attempt to persuade him otherwise. At least that is my knowledge. There was no attempt to make him reconsider and not go back, even though he knew there would be no retaliation with any of his fellow prisoners. It is indeed an incredibly strange concept to allow a prisoner to return home for this reason. Although I do add this, I imagine the same opportunity would not be provided to anybody of lower rank. And I know people are thinking that. Well, if he had been a young lad from Sheffield who served in a pal's regiment and wanted to go home, I'm not sure Kaiser Wilhelm would have given him the same opportunity. However, it doesn't diminish the story about Captain Campbell. What it does raise, because it's bizarre, it seems like an old-fashioned idea, an old-fashioned story, slightly ridiculous in our contemporary age. But what it does make us think about is, what is honor? Or do we consider it old-fashioned in our contemporary world, the concept of honor? I understand honor is a bond between an individual and society, or a member of society and other members of society, other individuals. Honor is a measure of the quality of a person regarding personal ethos. Honor manifests itself as a code of conduct and has various elements, such as valor. There are certain things I remember as being honor and slightly sacred because they were honorable. For instance, nobody ever touched another country's ambassador. Although tragically we did have, many years ago, a British ambassador to Dublin who was murdered in Dublin. But the general rule in every society that it gave some spark of honor and civilized behavior, you did not touch the ambassador or diplomats from a country, even if your country was in dispute with the other country. That was one. Another was the honor of recognizing sanctity or sanctuary of a church or a mosque or a synagogue or a temple. And I go back many, many years ago, and myself and Isabella were involved in a campaign where two young boys in Uri, were going to be shot by a terrorist organization for a very mild alleged misdemeanor that they committed. And myself and Isabella and other people traveled to Newry with Seamus Mallon. And we took those two young boys into Newry Cathedral and we claimed sanctuary for those two young boys. And they stayed and lived in Newry Cathedral for about a month. And nobody touched them. Nobody touched them. They were left there. Sadly, I don't think that would happen today. Today, I think the police would come into a church to take out asylum seekers or refugees. And another time I remember, I was in El Salvador, and there was an incredible, brutal war going on in El Salvador. And myself and other people brought people in taxis into the basement of the cathedral in El Salvador. People who had been bombed out of their homes but were regarded as suspicious by the military. And the military left them in the cathedral and never touched them for the duration of the war. I just give those examples of honor and sanctity. And I just wonder, has that disappeared? Maybe honor is being confident that you have done the right thing and that you have not done the accepted thing, which many people do. The going along thing, that you've done the right thing rather than doing the accepted thing. And in a bizarre way, that is the story of Captain Campbell. In his mind, the right thing to do was to go and see his mother before she died. It was the right thing to do by the Kaiser. Against all the odds, he must have had some spark of humanity that made him agree that this young man could go home for 2 weeks and that he respected the young man's honor as a gentleman and an officer. Now, all of that sounds amazingly old-fashioned, and we always just hear in the atmosphere today, change, change, and nobody's more in favor of change than moi. But at times I think it would be good to reactivate the concept of honor and trust in public life. We might look again at some of the old-fashioned values that we learned from our mums. And maybe that's why this young man wanted to go home, to thank his mum for the values that she had enshrined in him. We might just reconnect with those values and restate them once again to try and improve on today's society. I'm not sure how Captain Campbell returned to the prisoner of war camp, but the romantic in me likes to imagine this handsome young officer exiting from a trench in his uniform, full officer dress, waving a white hanky at the Germans, walking across no man's land to be greeted by a young German officer and maybe offered a glass of schnapps and told welcome and brought back to the prisoner of war camp. How it probably didn't happen that way. He probably went by train to Switzerland and around that way. However, that's the image I have. And taken back to his fellow inmates. Captain Campbell remained in the camp until the end of the war in 2018. His mum died 3 months after his visit. Amen. Trevor.
Well, good morning, and thank you for all your kind comments about the music in recent weeks for Harvest and for Remembrance. We were working, the choir and I, under difficult circumstances, and I'm delighted to see that most of them have returned hale and hearty, and hopefully in good voice. I think so. Now, I don't normally do requests, so don't be flooding me with emails. But I'd like to play this piece, my first opportunity to do so. It's a well-known piece of music from the movies. And I'm not sure where the camera will be. I think it's probably staying on a wide angle rather than catching me. It doesn't go over that angle to the console. So during this organ solo, it's on the organ, The camera will still be on you, choir, so don't be handing round the sweets. So this piece is called Gabriel's Oboe, and it's from the movie The Mission, and the music by Ennio Morricone. And like most movie music, it has two titles. It's got the working title in the score of the film. And there it's called The Nelly Fantasy, but it's much better known as Gabriel's Oboe. By the way, the oboe, I'm going to use the oboe on the organ as the solo instrument here. It can be a little bit strident, I think, on the ear. So I'm dropping the oboe out halfway through just to put some string effect in and bring the oboe back in again. I think that's more like Morricone had it in the original. I hope you approve. Gabriel's Oboe.
Thank you, Trevor. Now may we sing together our final hymn, and it's hymn number 56, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Thank you.
May the Eternal bless you and protect you. May the Eternal smile on you and favor you. May the Eternal befriend you and prosper you. Amen. God bless you all. Be safe and go in peace.